is culture permanent? Is it culture dynamic? How much of it is permanent? Is it really DNA? Or is it the DNA of the CEO? We don't know, we want to find out. Is it DNA of the organization or DNA of the leadership team? We would like to know what in the culture, what's happening. So strategically, what's happening in the culture? When it comes to the competency, we will talk to the panelists, sir. Are you redefining competency? Is there a different way of assessing competency? Is there a way of developing competency? Or is it organization-led, is it individual-led, in that competency? These will be your all of our takeaways, okay? So what we'll do is, we will ask the four worthy panelists. First, they will give their initial thoughts on the overall topic. Then we'll go little focused, little micro, specific questions that you'll ask, I'll ask. You will have to ask large number of questions. Many, many questions, okay? Be prepared for that. I already told you, these are the takeaways, four buckets. Your questions should be around those. You will get some answers, some insight. Okay, done? Are okay with me? Nobody says okay.
Yes.
This is like, looks like a Pravachan Samaroh. Pravachan Samaroh, only the first row is Srota. Second row is Sota. Third row is Sarota. Fourth row is Sarakta. Fifth row is Sushupta. We want Srotas if you want this session to be lively. Okay? We want more Srotas. We want worthy panelists. We will go from your initial thoughts on the total topic. So that the questions will arise. Right.
Vinay. Thank you, Mr. Rao. I think very interesting topic. So I'll break my comments sort of in three parts. I think the first thing you talked of is technology, and it takes me back to this book I read recently on digital transformation by Tom Siegel. I'm sure some of you read it. And I don't run an HR practice in any company that any of you, so my comments come more as an educator. But when we sort of think about what is the curriculum we create today, I think digital transformation is right at the top. So I think organizations are dealing with digital transformation, and today you ask any CEO, whether she runs a bank or she's head of a food delivery company, I think the biggest challenge organizations are dealing with is how do you integrate technology with your businesses? And this is not just about tech companies, but with any business, which means we as educators are also seeing that our students, what are the sort of competencies they have? You may have a literature student or a history student, but what is her digital competency, right? Or what is her propensity to get into that sort of a workforce and deal with digital transformation? So I think that is one challenge which is right up and center and right up front. I think the second challenge we deal with as educators, and this is a little bit to do with the history of higher education. Till about the 80s and the 1990s, you know, somebody who knew a lot of things, somebody who had knowledge, somebody who could remember a lot, somebody who could calculate faster, was considered smart, right? So that was the definition of being what a smart person is. Somewhere in the late 90s, early 2000s, that started to change. And what we hear of, this term is often now maligned, 21st century skills of critical thinking, problem solving, ability to connect the dots. You know, that sort of came center stage. And those skills became important. So you saw the whole rise of the liberal arts and even all curriculums, whether it's education, business. So while you have your competencies in math, programming, whatever, but your ability to navigate some of these other skills became extremely important. And I think the focus of educational institutions like ours was very concentrated in that direction. So that now I think the world is sort of again waking up and saying, look, what next? What is education going to look like in 2040? What are the skills that students should have when they are graduating in 2035, 2040? Tough question, we don't know. But I think the more sort of this discussion happens around technology, the more the sentiment comes across that, look, robots can do a lot of work that humans can do, but in some sense, they will never replace humans, right? So I think this whole notion of developing a stronger emotional quotient, your ability to collaborate, those notions still exist extremely strongly, and that's something I think the whole HR world and corporate world is aware of. But the question also is, what next? What is going to be important in 2035? And I'm quoting from So United Nations in the mid 90s set up this body to really say that what are the skills in 2040 that are going to be relevant. And I'm quoting one that came across, and that's probably where institutions, workplaces have to think about. And they said, look, the ability to deal with conflict and the ability to align people may emerge as a key skill that students should have in the future. I believe the curriculum organizations are sort of just starting to wake up to that reality. And millenniums often are bringing that thought along, right? I mean, they're coming in with so many conflicts in their minds that this ability to resolve conflicts, build consensus, carry people together is becoming important. So that's sort of the second dimension. What institutions need to do? What is the new paradigm of skills, knowledge that one should have? And I think the third dimension, lastly, is that what are the millennials coming with? I think the question that Mr. Rao asked, what are their aspirations? And I think in the limited understanding I have of dealing with students at our university or wherever else, I do believe the new generation is coming saying, look, I want to do good to myself, but I also want to do good to the world. I think this is a generation which, at least to a large extent, is not fighting the battle of existence or really wanting a livelihood, just a mere job. I think they want more meaning out of their jobs. They want a great job, but also are looking for deeper impact. What can they do beyond the classroom? I also feel they want to be challenged. You can't put them in a monotonous sort of job for too long. They are not coming in also saying, look, I'm here for the next 20 years of my life. Right? If you can retain them for 2 years, 4 years, 3 years, that's a great achievement. So I think they are coming in with their own set of expectations. I'm sure our distinguished panel here is better equipped to sort of deal with those questions than I am. So I'm probably going to park my thoughts in these three. I think what digital transformation is doing, what are the skills and competencies that educational institutions need to evolve, and what is the mindset that millennials are coming. So I'll
end on that. My quick, you are clapping for him? My quick thing was, he says, we have moved from IQ to EQ, and we have come to something different. I don't know if Rajan is here. Should we call it AQ, alignment quotient, or DQ, or CQ, something around that, no? Is it deconfliction, or is it conflict management? Is it alignment, or is it collaboration? Around that, he has hinted that. And last one is a tough one. They want meaningful work. So it's a very tough thing for the managers. You have to provide meaning. It's not delight, it's not satisfaction, it's not. It is the meaning. They are searching for a meaning in what they do. So we move to Smita. Be ready for initial thoughts.
Thank you so much for having me here. So, this is actually a very real issue that we deal with. I'm with AstraZeneca, it's a pharmaceutical company. We work in high-end innovation products. So technology, etc., is quite real for us. And we find that it's actually not daunting. And the way is to actually integrate it into your life. And we already have it in our lives, isn't it? I mean, personally, we all have some kind of health app hooked to ourselves. We know what we are doing. So from an HR perspective, what does all of that mean? In an organization, enabling your workforce to come together on some kind of a technology platform, on some kind of meaningful exchange, I think it sort of addresses all of what you raised, Vineet, earlier. So I actually think that instead of being afraid of technology, I think it's the time to embrace technology. And I think our millennials are really leading us in that journey. Really they are. With the use of technology, we have sort of democratized the entire workplace. It's no longer the bastions of the leaders to tell the employees what to do. It's actually everyone talks for each other, everyone talks together. Most organizations have some kind of internal Facebook or social media platform. A lot of comms is going on over there. You're getting real-time information, you're getting real-time feedback as well. You want to build a strategy, rather than sitting, having a workshop of the top 100 leaders in one conference room, what you do is you put it out over there on your internal social Facebook. And you have all employees actually telling you what they want to do for the future. a great way for you to source the next big idea. We call it crowdsourcing, and you think, do people really do it? Yes, they do it. They do it several times over, because that's the way to in the future. You want to engage your millennials, you want to give them purpose, you want to bring them up front in the cycle, and they tell you what is the next big wave of new ideas that they want to participate in, that they are seeing in their environment, that they want to bring to the workplace. With one program like that, you're actually bringing them into shaping the organization for the future. One of the things we keep talking about, how do you make a workplace where they would stick? Because a lot of data shows us that they don't stick for long, right? I would suggest that we should actually have them decide that for us. I think the days of prescription is long gone. We can't prescribe anymore to people. How long must you stay with me? Am I going to give you a career? These are the kind of career paths I have to offer to you. Versus saying, I have a plethora of opportunities. You have capabilities and you have interests. And you know what's right for yourself. So it's a very adult to adult conversation, really. It's not as if I'm going to, enable them. They are equally able to do what they wish to do. You know, they want to learn something new. It's all available. A lot of organizations have these platforms, right, where you have all the training material available. And you can just go there and you can look at whatever it is that you want to pick up your next skill, the next program. You have a lot of places, a lot of organizations have an internal gig economy where you, if you have 20% free time, you can actually apply for a project in some other part of the world and add value to them and also add value to yourself. So there are all of these very, very different democratized way of working, of skill building that's available in the organization. And these are just different ways of doing the same thing that we probably used to do earlier, but in a much more engaging and a lot more fulfilling way. You're no longer telling people what to do. People are volunteering. People are picking it up because it makes sense for them. So as a culture of an organization, all that we have to do is make sure that you have this kind of enablement. And it's okay for people to pursue their interest. And how as an organization we can build jobs and roles around people and their capabilities and their interests. And I think it's possible. It's just a different way of looking at the problem. But you can do it. Because I think one very important thing, and I think you mentioned it as well, Vineet, is that the millennials actually fill you with a lot of hope. They do. They're very positive. They want to do more. They want to add more value. They want to be counted. They are socially conscious. They want to have a purpose. And the best way to engage them is actually to link them with a purpose. Is to actually reiterate to them on every available opportunity how their work is actually socially meaningful. You know, how it actually goes out. And there are many examples. You know, in my organization, as I said, I'm a pharma company. So we do a lot of work in non-communicable diseases. And because of that, the kind of work we do with our employees is we take them out to underprivileged communities where they teach young kids how to avoid non-communicable diseases. We have a program running here in Delhi for the last 10 years we've touched the lives of over 400,000 children and young people. And this is why on one hand it's about community outreach, on the other hand it adds a lot of value to our people. We do cancer screening all over the country. Believe me, our employees go and do it. Yeah, of course we have doctors also who do it, but our employees also go and do it. They're terribly excited about it. And these are just, you know, and I'm sure everybody's sphere has these kinds of different opportunities that we have to really tap into to bring in that social awareness and ability for people to link to the bigger, the bigger cause.
Wonderful, wonderful thoughts. This is started with Jadoo Ki Jhappi. टेक्नोलॉजी को जादू की झप्पी दे दो, हाँ, अभी ले लो, मिलेनियल्स को आप ज्ञान मत दो, हाँ, उनको आप ज्ञान मत दो, they know what is required to be done, what they can do, उनको खाली बता दो क्या अपॉर्चुनिटीज है, और उनको याद दिला दो कि उनका क्या कैपेबिलिटीज है, एंड सेंटर अराउंड पर्पस, अगर एचआर लग जाए, क्रिएटिंग ए पर्पस, कम्युनिकेटिंग ए पर्पस, ऑफरिंग ए पर्पस, मेकिंग अदर्स लीव द पर्पस, एचआर का काम हो जाएगा. गुड इनिशियल थॉट्स. ओके, विल मूव टू, वी हैड एजुकेशनिस्ट, वी हैड ए प्राइवेट सेक्टर एमएनसी पर्सपेक्टिव, नाउ विल गो टू पब्लिक सेक्टर पर्सपेक्टिव. दैट्स ऑल.
थैंक यू जीपी. लेट मी फर्स्ट इंट्रोड्यूस दिस पार्ट फ्रॉम द पीएससी पॉइंट ऑफ व्यू. See, I am from Steel Authority of India Limited, which is almost a company which has 60 years in existence. 60 years, in this 60 years, I think all generations, and I will say three generations of the same person is still working. Grandfather is working, the father is working, and the grandson is also working. So all the kinds of persons, but the competencies which we used to have at that point of time, 1950s, is totally different from what we will hire now. And I agree with the first speaker, Mr. Vineet, that the colleges don't know what kind of competencies they should give it to us, because when really the I will say children's only, because I am too old at the moment for 35 years, I have already done, my service is more than 35 years. When these children, so then these people, new millennials, join the organization, they don't know really what exactly the kind of competencies they should have. And really, we have to inculcate in them. But then the issue is, again, the issue is slightly very different. Now, if you tell them the purpose, if you tell them the purpose that this is the technology which is there, in our organization also, there are certain areas which are very much technology driven, because they have been modernized, and the, from the technological point of view, they are in this third generation or fourth generation machines are there. There we are saying that the only a single person is managing the entire show. But then the areas where the other the old technologies are still working, the managing is totally a different ballgame. That is one part, but then the competencies which are really required is totally a different ballgame. And I will say, if an individual is provided with the purpose, the new man, he is able to do much more than what exactly the older lot is doing. I can share an example. If suppose in the Bhilai steel plant, our one of the project is the rails, and rail is being the national thing which has to be delivered to the railways. So if the team is aware of that, this kind of rejections will give them this kind of issues, they will be so much into it that the rejections will be comparatively much less, and they will be able to take care of all the things which is giving them a purpose that these are the issues, and I think by virtue of that they will be able to deliver whatever you want them to deliver. Similarly, the kind of Madam Smita has said regarding the technology, I will say they have the knowledge of technology so high that earlier we used to say the issue used to be that who has the maximum knowledge and who has the maximum thing. Who captures the maximum of the finale of the HR. Kisko sab kuch bata hai, but aaj ki date mein uski koi zarurat hi nahi hai, because everything, whatever is the rules and regulations, they are on the manual, they are on the net. Every person has the, he is aware of the fact that these are the things which are available to me, and I am entitled to these things. It is not whims and fancies of the Mr. X and Mr. Y, that this is something which is not, I cannot give you.